Good morning to everybody. Today we are starting the lab number eight. In this lab number eight is particularly important because it deals with the first aspect related to the classification. And therefore, now we will see in more detail how to approach the classification issues, and that is dealing, of course, with the extraction of information from data. And in order to do that, we will start with double labs, in which in this first one, we will deal with unsupervised classification, while in the second part, that is split into two different labs, we will approach the supervised classification. And of course, in this case, we also approach the training phase of the classification. So with this lab, we are looking for a particular data set in these labs. So in this case, the data set is loaded as usual. So OpenEyes optical sensor, and let's go to Landsat, all right, and let's go with GeoTIFF with metadata. All right. At this point, now we are going to point in the folder where we have these materials, and I'm selecting. I don't know where you have these data, and we are going to this folder that is called Amazonas. That stands for Amazon, of course, and that is a very particular data set that is, I mean, that will allow us to make assessment very interesting concerning also to environmental conditions. So let's go to the Amazon data set, and let's open double-clicking the MTL, the metadata file. You see that is quite old because the acquisition is on the, you see, in the 2002, the 29th of November in 2002, you see here. Okay, let's open that. All right, you see, as usual, we are in the visible with the image centered. This is a very small piece of display of the whole image. And you see, let's go to the overview in the layer manager, you see. And this is the overview. If I'm zooming out, this is the whole image. All right. So in order to better describe the image, let's close the overview and let's go to the data manager in order to describe the data. Let's go to the band selection tab. All right. And let's associate a false color image. So this is a Landsat 7 where the you see we have six band. So the band 4 is the near infrared associated to the red band, then the red to the green, and the green band to the blue channel, right? So let's load that in a new view and load the data. All right, so we have the screen split into different display. All right, so you see here this is the false color. All right, the representation scale are different. So at this point, we are basically linking these two views in order to move accordingly in the two views themselves. Okay, let's link all here. Okay, you see here, clicking here, we are linking. Of course, it's a geolink because the image is georeferenced, while a pixel link is based on image coordinates. So that means that you don't need a georeferenced image with a pixel link. But of course, we have this image that is georeferenced. So that means that, I mean, we can link the two images in a classical way. So let's link all, okay, you see, and let's press OK. So you see here, now we have the two images linked. So I don't like to see these vertical views. So maybe from here in views, let's go to two horizontal views, just because I want to see better features on the image. So with the hands, I'm pan the image, you see, and I want to go here to this river that we have here, right? So just to understand, this is a very small piece of the Amazon. In order to understand where we are, we can go to the views here in the main menu, and we can go to the reference map link you see here. Let's click that, and you see. Here we are in the middle of nothing. You see here, there's really nothing. The closest city are Santarém, Parintins, and Oriximiná, Alenquer, e other. But we are on the Amazon River. You see here, this is a very particular piece of the Amazon area, of the Amazon, because you see here there are areas. There are more than flooded area. There are meanders of the Amazon River that accumulate stable water in that area. For example, here in this case, we have the Lago Grande de Cujá. Okay, you see here, I'm zooming out just to understand where we are. So you see that I'm in that position just east to Manaus, that is the capital city of the Brazilian Amazon. All right? So, very good. Let's try to better understand what this image represents. The first things we can select, you see, this image, the true color. You see that we have this cyan frame. That means that this is the selected views. So, for example, we can improve the contrast. For example, we can do to the linear 2% here, you see. And if I'm selecting the second view, the first color one, and we can do that or graphically or like that, just going to the name of the band, all right? You see here. So I can have a couple of options, or graphically, or selecting the name of the file in the layer manager as usual. So now we selected the fourth color one, and in this case, I'm going also in the linear 2% contrast stretching. You see? Then now I have a better representation of the Amazon River and the system. So if I'm zooming right here, let's check what we have in this image. In this image, we have the Amazon River that in this case, you see the water, and for example, this channel that is coming upstream, you see here the water is quite different from this one. You see, it's very dark in the first column. But you see here, there's a full of vegetation, of course, it's forest. It's very dense forest that is in red in the first color. You see here there are many clouds that is very common in this tropical area because it's coming from the evapotranspiration of the vegetation. And you see, then we have all these zones here. You see that are brownish, this area and greenish in the first color. That are nothing else, that areas, and you see that there's a road in the middle, and these are deforested area, you see, that are very straight texture, straight shape, that are very easily distinguishable, that are, basically are part of the deforesting operation. So, one of the most important things here is that, what is very important is that this area of deforestation are not really used for cultivation, but using for grazing animals, for feeding animals, where you have here cattle that they are brought there by these roads and just left there in order to be fed. And so, I mean, these deforested areas are always, I mean, characterized by having some access route in order to use this part of the forest. And in this case, we have a dendritic tree pattern of deforestation that is really typical of the different things we have. So you see here another possibility is that is dendritic in the dendritic pattern, because we can also access this area by the river, of course. So if you are going there by boat, I mean you can deforestate it, because you can access. You see here there's a very slow stream there, when you can enter with a very small boat and you can deforestate it there. That's awful, but I mean, this is the pattern that you can find when you are approaching deforested areas. So in this case, we want to use this image in order to recognize these surfaces that we have in this image that has very few. So you see that one of the main surfaces is water, and we have water in two different conditions, because I mean the Amazon River is, for example, in this image, very greenish, while the upstream channel is very dark, as you see. And so there you see that they are full of sediments, and this is the meaning of that. While the upstream channel is very dark, that means that maybe we don't have any sediment or something in suspension into the water. So we have vegetation that is forest, and we can have two types of vegetation that is usually forest and maybe some cultivation. I don't really know if it's forested, because I mean, you see here, it's not red in this case, you see, it's greenish. So that means that is a sort of a bare soil of with a very low vegetated. I mean, maybe just a sort of grassy background, or even bare soils, for example. Probably, if pastoralism is implemented, maybe the vegetation no longer exists. And then we have also clouds. This is another feature that is in this image. And you see that we have also another thing that is very important from the statistical point of view, that is not really a surface, but this is the shadows of the clouds, and the clouds are projecting these shadows over the surfaces of this image. You see here? So they are projecting these shadows both on the vegetation, but you see here also on the water. So I mean, basically we have very few surfaces, so water, vegetation, maybe something that is deforested, clouds, and then we have the shadow of the clouds. Then we have also these structures here. You see, I don't really know what they represent, but our aim is to understand this, for example, these different surfaces are in somehow extractable from the image. And so we like to understand if they have in the different spectral bands of the data set we have acquired. So we can disjoint this data set, these features, and you remember that we already tried to do that with the density slicing, with the scatter plot, and also with the algebraic operation. And in that case, you remember that we can disjoint these different sets, these different features, but now we want to approach this problem. And you see that are different in these two, the visualization in Foscolor and in the lower part, and two color in the upper part. And so we want to understand if out of these six different spectral bands we can extract these surfaces. But in order to do that, we need to perform our basic operation because we don't want to work with digital number, but we want basically proceed with the radiometric corrections. So we want to calibrate our image, and to calibrate this image, you remember, we are going to the toolbox here in the radiometric correction, and we are going to radiometric calibration here, you see, double clicking. We are selecting the first data set, you see, that is the first one, you see, is the six band we are using of the Lanza 7 ETM enhanced thematic mapper sensor. I'm pressing OK. You see here, I have the radiometric calibration as usual. And in this case, you see, we have all the different tabs, the different parameters, in which, for example, I'm changing reflectance. The band interleave, we can leave BSQ, the band sequential. The output data type is floating point, because, I mean, we will have, as a result, a real number. And you remember that the radiometric resolution of this image is 1 byte, and we will transform that in more than 1 byte in order to have a number of bits that are sufficient to show a real number that is ranging from 0 to 1. It's, of course, it will be a decimal number, so I mean a single byte is not enough in order to save this kind of value, and so we need a floating point, 2 or 3 different bytes. So we need that in order to save our results. Then the scale factor is and the apply the flash settings is okay. I mean, let's leave as they are. The output file name, let's save that. Okay, so let's go. For example, I'm going to the download folder, and then call the. In this case, we are the best thing is to select the original name of the file. So you see here, I already done that. So I call that Amazonas underscore cal dot dot. And opening that, of course, in my case, it's already there, yes. And I'm going to press OK. All right. So you see, it's nothing happening, but you see there that lower right, I have this bar that is telling us that, I mean, the calibration is proceeding with all the processing. So when the processing ends, we will add this image in the layer manager, and they will appear in our display. You see, it's quite slow because, I mean, there's a bunch of operation. Now it's ready, all right? So now we have this list, and you see, it's in these windows. This is the calibrated data, and this is, of course, in the visible because it depends on the preferences. All right, let's check if this is already calibrated. You see, it seems to be very similar to the previous one, but right-clicking with this new file, all right, in order to check from the statistical point of view the consistency of the data. So Amazon underscore cal dot dat, right-click, it's reprojected, of course, because it has inherited the reference system, right-click, and let's open the quick starts. Just to see if how is the distribution of the new calculated data. This scene, you remember, is more or less 7,000 by 7,000 big. So I mean, there were more or less 50 millions of different cells in these data sets. So this is the, I remind you, that is the calibration procedures in which from the digital number we are going back to the radiance or reflectance value. So we are going back to the physical process. Here it is the values. So you see band 1, band 2, till 2, band 6. Of course, then pay attention that the order is a progressive one, where for 1 to 5 it's okay, but band 6 is corresponding to the band 7 of the data sets, because band 6 in this case, in this sensor, is a thermal. And you see that the minimum and maximum value are compressed between 0 and 1, more or less. If we are going to check all the histograms, you see they are there, and we are also here. Maybe less close, less. Gave up the visibility. You see, they are all value comprised between 0 and 1. All right. So this is the calibration. All right. You remember that after this operation, we are not done yet, because we need to correct the selective scattering in order to have everything corrected. So let's go to the toolbox here in radiometric correction, and we are going to the dark subtraction. So in the dark subtraction, double clicking, we are selecting the file that is already calibrated, the Amazonian CalData. In this case, we cannot use all the file, and you remember why? Because I mean we have the background that is equal to 0. So let's go to the spatial subset. Let's go here, the button image. All right, let's use a window that is 3000 by 3000, so we have all the same dimension, and put that maybe let's use a bigger one. So, for example, 4000 by 4000. All right, and let's put that. The windows, the red frames, without intersecating the background. Otherwise, I mean, the dark subtraction is not working. For example, put these windows here. For example, all right, this one. You can choose, freely choose where you can put that. And let's consider that this operation that now we are doing, could be extremely useful for the calibration, but we will use this file also for the next lab. So don't delay these files, because we will use that again in the next labs with the supervised classification. All right, 4000 by 4000. Okay, let's press OK here. Let's press also OK here. Let's use, of course, all the bands. Let's press OK, and now we are. This is the dark subtraction parameters windows, using, of course, the band minimum, because we cannot, we not, don't have any user value or any region of interest yet. All right. So let's choose the name of the file, and let's use, for example, the. I already did that. You see here is Amazonas underscore cal underscore ds, that stands for dot subtraction dot dot, in order to have all the information. It's already existing in my folder. I press OK. Of course, I'm rewriting that, and you see this is the processing of the dark subtraction. All right, I'm sorry. This is the results. Okay, is okay. This is the is more or less the same, but you see it seems to be more bright. Okay, let's again, as before, we are going to the layer manager, right click, and extract the quick starts. All right, there is quicker because the file is smaller than the previous one. It's only 4000 by 4000, that means 60 millions of cells. All right, that you see that our data are changing between very close to zero. You see here it's almost zero, to one, of course, because they are still reflectance value. So these two processing, the calibration and the dark subtraction, is corresponding to the top of the atmosphere calibration. This is the histogram, you see. That is very similar to the digital filters, because in this case, you see, you remember, we show that we have a bimodal distribution. In this band 4 here, this peak is representing water and this part is representing vegetation. So what we said in the lectures is very real also from the operational point of view. A bimodal distribution where we have basically two big surfaces, vegetation and water. So at this moment, we can begin to think that we can use our first classification. So we are going to the toolbox. I'm closing the radiometric connection folder. And you see, this is in alphabetical order. So I'm going to the classification. I'm exploding this folder. And you see, I have a different possible classification. But what is needed, it's in the two leather folders, so supervised classification and unsupervised classification. Let's start with the unsupervised classification. And you see, we have two different algorithms, the isodata classification and k-means classification. K-means is very similar to isodata. We describe the isodata. So let's double click on the isodata classification. And let's select in these windows the dataset that we want to use. And in this case, we are using, of course, the Amazonas calibrated and thus subtracted, of course. In this case, I mean, this is the dataset, you see 4,000 by 4,000. At this point, if you remember what are the different steps that are part of the isodata classification, you remember that at the beginning, there is the only interaction that is requested with the user. And if you remember, it's based on two particular points. The first concern the choice of a number of classes to use, and the second concern the number of bands to be used. In this case, the second option is made from this menu, because you see here, apart from this spatial subset, and we are using the full scene, here the spectral subset is the exact timing in which you are extracting the bands. So let's imagine to use the six bands, but consider that having choose the six bands, if you have already went through the theoretical part of the isodata classification, in the second point of the isodata classification, in the theoretical part, you remember that in this case, is being built a possible scatter plots with a dimension that is equal to the spectral bands you are used. So in this case, if choosing six bands, we will have a sort of scatter plots in six different dimensions. Okay, mass band is not relevant for our case, so we can press OK, full scene with all the bands. All right, this is the window that is defining the isodata parameters. And in this case, we want to have more attention. First line of these windows, in this case, we are defining the number, the minimum and maximum number of classes that and in this moment we are defining the second option of the theoretical explanation we have. How many classes do you want to look for to search in the image? In this case, it makes not really sense to search for only two classes. And in this case, the range is from 5 to 10. If I want to search, for example, five classes, okay, the minimum and maximum will be the same number. So in this case, I can search for an exact number of classes. All right. We basically said that here we have a number of classes that we expected to see after the classification. And in this case, it's very limited, the number of classes, because we have here vegetation, deforested area, water, clouds, and shadows of the clouds. But in this case, we cannot say in advance that there could be any other classes. For example, we can also admit that the forest is not done by the same essence, but by the same trees, but could also be represented by different type of vegetation. So in this case, so it's better to leave this option from 5 to 10. Let's see at the end how many classes would be extracted. This is the number of iteration. In this case, we have one, but this make any sense to put only one, because from the theoretical path, you remember that we will have 10 centuries in this case that are randomly positioned on the scatter plots. So with only one interaction, of course, we are not going to convergence, because you remember that the isodata is iterative. But in particular here, we have in this third tab the change thresholds. You remember that in the theoretical, being this algorithm an iterative algorithm, we must define thresholds from which it arrives to the convergence. And therefore, we have said that from the theoretical point of view, that in the moment what changes at each single step of the algorithm is changing the position of the centroids. So from the theoretical point of view, in the case of these scatter plots in six dimension, dealing with reflectance, we could define that the thresholds could be that is characterized by six different coordinates, because we have a six dimension scatter plots. At the last interaction, for example, the centroids of a particular class in this reflectance data set, for example, should not move more than the standard deviation, for example, of all the cell that is attributed to the particular class. In this case, in ENVI, the threshold is calculated in a different way. So you see here, change thresholds, 0, 100 in percentage, and this is the 5%. That means that if in the last interaction the number of total cell that is assigned to the particular class is lower than the 5% dot dose in the penultimate interaction, then the algorithm converge. So this threshold is based on the total number of cells that are assigned to the different centroids. And so we will iterate a certain number of iterations, and when all the classes at the n iteration compared to the penultimate, and all the number of cells that are assigned to the classes is not more than 5% of the last iteration, the iteration stops. In this case, I remember I saw you that I told you in the theoretical part that the implementation in ENVI is wrong, because in reality this is very theoretical, and in practice there are no major consequences. But this threshold is wrong, because calculating the total number of assigned cell, for example, you can have in two successive iterations the same number of cells assigned to the same class, but if you are going to check on the image, these cells are in different places. So I mean, the difference of a certain percentage of the number of cells that is assigned to the class, it doesn't tell me which cells on the image are being associated to that particular centroids. So, I mean, in this case, you don't have a local spatial assignments. So, I mean, for example, in a particular centroid, for example, the forest, I can assign the same number of cells of the previous iteration. But if I'm going to check the cells that are assigned to the centroid forest in the two different iterations, maybe I can check that there are different parts of the forest that have been assigned. So, I mean, from the theoretical point of view, this criteria is not working, but I mean, from the operational point of view, is quite similar to the results. In any case, what absolutely must be done in this way is to increase the number of iterations. For example, we can put 10 here, leaving the 5% thresholds. If it's converging before 10 iterations, of course, the algorithm will stop. Here we have some different boundary conditions. For example, the first one that if we have a class, this class will be represented at least by one cell in every single class. You say it's a sort of paradoxical to have a class with only one cell, but let's leave that. Maximum class standard deviation. Okay, here is one. This one, of course, and now is very important because we will see that in the supervised classification. When we have thresholds relating to the standard deviation, pay attention that the value reported in these menus here is not an absolute value, but is a module of standard deviation. For example, to say one means that the standard deviation is one time the standard deviation, or while here minimum class distance means that there will be defined within a certain class all the cells that are last 5 times the standard deviation of the calculated cell. Therefore, these are modules and these are not absolute values. All right? So pay attention to that. Maximum when searching 10 classes, it doesn't necessarily say that we will define 10 classes, but there are two classes that are very similar, so the centroids are very close to each other. At that point, the algorithm will design in the last steps to perform a possible merge, that is to fuse two different centroids, and that is two different classes. In this case, you see here, the hypothesis is that if you have two centroids that are close, will merge pairs of centroids, and not more than two. Maximum standard deviation from mean and maximum distance error, these are constraints that we are not defining in this step, and for example, that are the first two, we don't define that, and we perform that operation in memory. All right? Let's click OK. You see that this is the first iteration. You see? So the first in the first steps, he extracted the statistical value, like what we do, we usually do extracting the statistical value. And now you see it's performing the different iterations. Now we have in the second iteration. So being the image 4,000 by 4,000, we have 16 millions of cells. We have 10 different centroids. So for every single iteration, it's performing at least 160 millions of operation. And so at the fourth iteration, we are not in convergence yet. You see? Of error failed to create a projected raster. So what's the problem? The problem is that, of course, I put that in memory. And this is also useful for me in order to also make you available the possibility to learn by error. So I'm removing bad things here. I'm going again in the unsupervised classification, the ISO data. So this is in memory. I taking the Amazonas cal.ds. Okay, so we are doing what we did before. All right, 10 iteration here. Okay, and I choose now the name. Okay, and I call that ISO data 1.dat. Maybe it's better to put that Amazonas underscore ISO data 1. All right, I save it. because I have the feeling that this is the problem, that I put that in memory. Okay, so now it's starting with the first iteration. See, it's a bit a little bit slower because now it's writing on my hard disk because the access rate to the RAM memory and to the physical memory is different. Of course, to the RAM is quicker the access to the physical hard disk. So you see here it's slower than before. Right, so we are in the fourth interaction right now. And you see here is, okay, after the fourth interaction is finished. You see, this is the result. All right. Let's check the results. All right. Let's zoom out just in order to better understand what has happened. You see, we are not classified the whole image, but only part of this image. All right. So you see all the greenish area. Greenish areas are basically, they are representing water. In particular, the Amazon's river, and in particular in this stagnant water. In the middle of this water, you see, we have these yellowish areas, while the forest, you see, is basically characterized by the blue color. While this water upstream from the north, from the isodata, you see, is red, and the isodata is extracting that in a different class than the water of the Amazon River, because it's basically different from that. You see, it's a clustering algorithm, this one. So then we have these yellow areas. Let's see what you see that are basically representing. You see here the deforested areas. You see here. You see. And they are the major part of the deforested area. You see that the clouds are mainly represented in cyan. You see here. While the shadows of the clouds are represented in red. So you see that our classes have been extracted in a very coherent form. So the meaning of using an automatic classification, in this case a supervised classification, is to make us understand if the different sets that we want to extract from the image are distinguishable within our classes from the statistical point of view. And another possibility of using this unsupervised classification is, for example, if we want to characterize in thematic maps a phenomenon that we are not knowing before. So, for example, if we want to represent the Amazon River in terms of turbidity or sediments present in the water, I mean, I cannot extract a region of interest from here. And so we can use an isodata classification in order if, for example, inside of these green areas that we have, we can distinguish different subclasses of this particular water that perhaps is representing different water conditions. But in this case, you see, it's quite useful, this example. A very particular important aspect of this supervised classification is that the isodata classification, or better, the results of this classification, is a pseudocolor image, the results. You know what is a pseudocolor image, in which every single color we have the representation of a particular color in a particular digital number. So you see here that the classified image that you see that now is superimposed to the other image, and you see it's having and it's inheriting the reference system. So I mean, it's in the right position. But what you can see here in the layer manager, we can right clicking on the results of the classification, extracting the quick stats. What does it mean, the quick stats in this case? We have only one single bands, you see here. And in this case, the statistics are quite different from the data that we used till now. This is a single band, a classified band, in which you see we have, when we have these crosses, of course, it's characterized by having a single bands. So the black cross is the mean value, the green two are the standard deviation, and the red the maximum and minimum. And from here, we can understand basically that we have five different digital numbers from one to five. You see here, one, two, three, four, five. And these five different digital numbers are not, I mean, they are not anything to concern with the reflectance, because this is the results of the classification, but these are the identifier of the different classes. So that means that out of 10 possible classes, you remember we select in the ISO data from 5 to 10. In this case, the ISO data, we started five different classes. And to the digital number is associated a particular numbers. Usually the first one is the red, the second is the green, the third is the blue, and then four and five are complementary colors. In our case, they are cyan and maybe yellow, cyan and yellow. So in this case, the digital number, they don't have any connection with the physical reality, but they are representing the different classes. So you can fully understand that there's no sense in this image to perform algebraic operation with spectral bands, because in this case, the digital number have nothing to do with the reflectance or radiance of the image, but they are simply values that indicate the five different classes in which we have associated the data in order to extract an information. So you see that the histogram here is that they have only five different digital number, you see. And in this case, we can left click, and for example, here the class number three, that is the blue value, is what is could be associated to the forest. So in this case, the number of cells that are associated to the digital number are the cells that are associated to the particular class. All right. So for example, the fourth is the yellow, and the five values could be the shadows. Right. So you see that also the pseudo color images, the results of the classification, has an histogram that is very important in order to understand how many cells have been associated to a particular class. So at this point, let's basically verify how we can check the characteristics of the different classes. I'm closing that, all right, in order to, I can go to the cursor location value, you see here, I'm zoom in it. I'm sorry, I want to understand what particular digital number is associated with the blue class here. So, and in RGB, that will be 00255 RGB. So if I'm clicking here, you see in the current view, you see the other geographical coordinates. This is the Amazonas ISO data. You see that data three class equal to three. So the digital number of the blue class is the number three. Right? Let's check the red. And the red, you see, is class one. The green will be the class two. You see that? The yellow, let's check class four. And if I'm zooming in cyan class, you see the class cyan is class five, all right? So you see there's a big difference that exists in case of classified and an original image. If I'm going back to check the quick stats, you see here, and I'm going to the histogram band two, you see, when I'm clicking with the left button here of the mouse, here, the number three value, you see here, let's read that. the results here when we click with the left button of the mouse, and this is the how many cells are represented by in the class. You see that I have here more than 9 million of different cells, 9.5 million cells. And considering that these cells are 30 by 30, 30 by 30 meters, you can also calculate the surface of what is considered to be forest, for example, for the class 3. Very good. So, if you are going back to this histogram, it's particularly interesting in order to calculate some particular operation. So now let's perform some ancillary operation. You see that the cursor here in the red class is the number one, for example. From this image, we can perform some algebraic operation, for example. So let's go to the algebraic operation. For example, I want to extract all the cells that have the value equal to one, all right? And only the class one. So I'm going to the toolbox Band Algebra, Band Math, and here in the expression, I can say B1 space EQ, that stands for equal, space one, all right? So let's extract from this database, from this image, all the values that are equal to one. All the cells that are equal to one will be represented in one, all the other in zero. So I'm associating B1 to the ISO data classification, all right? I put that in memory, all right? I don't want to say that. I force that in memory, okay? It's not, I gave out from the memory these things here, and we do that again. So Band Math, B1 equal to one, okay? I'm associating B1 to the ISO data, okay? All right, I put that in memory. All right, I call that, for example, B1 EQ1 dot dot. All right, and I press OK. All right, and this is the results. Of course, you remember that the results is completely dark because we have an auto stretch set in the preferences. You remember that as usual. So, I mean, we can do right clicking in here. So, if I'm going to the stretch, for example, to the Gaussian, you see, in the Gaussian, you see, we have all the data that we have. In this case, you see, we have all the water from here, but you see that I have also all the other things here. And what are these things here? These things here are the shadows of the clouds that are very similar of the water of this upstream channel. But you see here that I can use a algebraic operation in order to extract classes from a classification. All right, let's finish now doing another couple of examples from here. So I'm deleting and removing this operation from here, and at this moment I'm closing the Band Algebra folder, and I'm going again to the classification. Let's perform another ISO data classification. All right, so double click on that. We are using the Amazonas CalDES data, that means calibrating dust subtraction. What I want to do right now, if I'm using a smaller number of bands, spectral bands, the result is changing. So in the spectral subset, don't want to use the seven bands, considering that the first three bands are very correlated to each other. I can think to use only one of the three bands. I'm using so three bands. I'm using also four bands, and considering that five and seven bands that are mid-infrared are correlated, I'm only selecting three bands out of six. So I'm taking three, four, and five. All right. And in this case, they are very correlated, the bands. So we will have a three-dimensional scatter plots. And I want to check if the results of the classification using a lower number of spectral bands will be similar to what we have already extracted in the previous ISO data classification. So in this case, if I'm using score-related bands, I want to check if I have more possibility to define more number of classes. There's an int. Let's check if it is working. Only three bands. I'm sorry, I'm pressing OK. I'm leaving the unchanged, the previous parameters. So I'm setting 10 iteration. I put that in an image, in a file, I'm sorry. So for example, I can call Amazonas ISO data 2, for example, in order to distinguish from the previous, and then launching the procedure. I'm sorry. So this is the first iteration. And let's check at which iteration will arrive to the convergence of the parameters. So this is the third iteration. You remember 60 million of cell for 10 centroids. That means 160 million of calculation to every single stems. Okay, after four steps, it's closed and as before. So let's check how to compare this data that are on the same view. And for example, I move these particular things here and I'm moving to the other view. All right. Let's check if I drag that. I'm sorry. I cannot succeed in moving that. I'm sorry. I'm trying to drag. All right. Let's do another things. I'm going to the layer manager, to the data manager. I'm sorry. I'm closing that. All right. So you see, all right. So ISO data 1 and ISO data 2. So I can take, I'm sorry here. I'm selecting the first view, the upper one. All right, and now I'm selecting ISO data 2. All right, and I'm load the data. All right, okay, there's another way to do the same things. So the two displays are still linked. So in this moment, I can, okay, gave out the visibility of the same ISO data. So in this case, in the upper part of the screen, I see the ISO data 2, and in the lower part, I have the ISO data 1. You see? ISO data 1, 5, and only 6 class. You see that the classification are different. For example, in the border of the river, I have a green class. Here I have something that is yellowish. Here in this area, in the forested area, I have a red part that seems to be red. So you see, and you see here, for example, the different classes are very different. So the rivers was green, now is red, and it's red as the river as before. So you see, it seems that is happening something very important. They're using only three bands. You see here, all the water of the Amazon River and of the upstream channel here, that using seven spectral bands are in two different classes, using only three spectral bands are in the same class. You see, this is very interesting. Because you see, if I want to classify only the water in the same class, it's better to use a lower number of bands. You see here, if I want to see what I want to check, the red part that are represented with seven bands, the shadow of the clouds are the same of the water. In this case, it's not happening anymore. The water and both the upstream channel and the Amazon River is always red. So you see that is something What I'm asking, these are the same number of class in the second classification in comparison with the previous one. So let's go to the layer manager, right-clicking, quick starts, and you see that we have still five different bands from one to five. And I'm sorry, if I'm checking the histogram, you see that it's very similar to the previous one. In the third class, you see the classes are changed because when in the first class here, the one, we have many cells that are represented by these particular classes because here we have all the water. Okay, let's close that. And you see that what I want to show you is that I'm using a different number of spectral bands. So the results of the classification is basically very different. And I mean, in the second case, if you want to extract the water, it's better to use a lower number of bands. While if you want to characterize the different kind of water, it's better to use another larger number of bands. So let's relaunch, sorry, another classification in the spectral subsets. Let's use only the visible bands. All right, let's do another example. So this is an example when we are trying to classify that with only a visible band. So, for example, what we can have if on board of the satellites and just taking a picture with our mobile phone, for example. Let's check what we can classify only with the visible bands. And this is what we can catch with our eyes. And so let's check if we can select five different classes only using these three bands. So let's proceed. Let's perform exactly the same classification with the same parameters. So I only take 10 iteration. I'm save that with ISO data 3, Amazonas ISO data 3. All right, let's click open and let's. Okay, so it will these results will be in the first view. All right, so let's start to classify. This is the first iteration. And let's check the results using only the three visible bands of the data sets. Second iteration. Third iteration. Fourth iteration. Fifth iteration. So you see that the convergence is far away from the previous one, okay? This is the results. You see? The results is completely different, you see? It's completely different because from the visible, it's extremely complicated the classification. The forest became red, but apart from the color that I'm not really interested, that this part of forest, this is still forest, but you see it's another class. So in that case it was completely blue. In this case it split in two different parts. So you see, these are part of forest that are associated to another class. Rivers, you see here, in one case are yellow, in the other case are green, like the other part of forest. So it's all mixed. All this blue part there is different from all the other things. That this deforested area, you see, they are both blue and green. So I mean, everything is mixed. So that are very similar to these humid and wetlands that we have the southern part of the image. So this is very important to make you understand this latter classification, that the approach using only the visible bands, especially in such of an image in which we have only few different classes. In this case, you see, using only the visible is quite impossible to extract data sets, classes that have any sense. So, what we said in the theoretical part, In the supervised classification, you see, should be attributed a posteriori, so that is after the classification. So this is one of the most important things of the unsupervised classification. For example, here in the green part, the green class is something that is related to the Amazon River, and in this case, the blue part is forest. But these things should be attributed after the classification and not a priori, like we will see in the supervised classification. So we are going a bit long for this lab because we will talk about supervised classification in the next two labs, so in number 9 and number 10. But I would like to end with the last example of isodata classification. So let's relaunch the isodata. Let's take again the original data using all the six different bands. Let's put 10 iterations, but let's change a parameter. Let's change that parameters. Maximum standard deviation from mean. What does it mean? That means that the cells that will be associated to a certain class only if they have a distance from the centroids that is not higher than these thresholds. What is this thresholds? As I mentioned before, it's a module of standard deviation. This is not an absolute value. So if I put here 1, 2, 3, or 4, that means 1, 2, 3, or 4 times the standard deviation. So all the cells that have a distance greater from the centroids of 1, 2, 3, or 4 standard times the standard deviation will not be associated to that particular centroids. So all those cells that will be have a lower value than the thresholds will be associated to that particular centroids. All right? So let's put, for example, 3 times the standard deviation. All right? Every time we are inputting data, let's press enter in this case. Let's leave this maximum distance error blank. Let's put only these 3. All right. So for every single centroid in this case, and maybe we will have 5 centroids, we will associate it to the cells in different colors, all the cells that are not far. More far than 3 times the standard deviation of the data sets that has been associated to the centroids. All the cells that are outside this distance, that have a distance bigger than that one, will not be classified, all right, in that particular centroids. All right? Let's select the name of the file. Let's call that, for example, isodata number 4. I'm sorry, I'm writing 43. Okay, let's open that. Okay, let's press okay. And let's check how many interactions we need for that. So it's lower. It's lower because in this case, it's setting another test. So for every single distance that has been calculated, I mean, it's checking with the module of the standard deviation. All right? So this is why it's lowering the speed of the performance of this implementation of the isodata algorithm. So you see, we are in the third iteration. Now we are in the fourth iteration. So you see that these things is slowing down the procedure. We are in the fourth, now in the fifth iteration. So that means that we have a step and more steps. So this is the sixth iteration. It's not arriving to convergence. So I mean, it's using also the sixth iteration. Let's check if it's finishing. No, it's going to the seventh iteration. So let's check if it's stopping. Okay, after seven iteration, it stopped. This is the results. You see, the results is completely different from before. You see, it's prevailing in this image, the black values. Let's right-click on the isodata 4. Let's extract the quick stats. All right? And you see that in the quick stats, I'm sorry, here. Okay, now we have six classes because we have also the zero class. What is the zero class? All the cells that are not being classified by the algorithm. That means that all the cells have a distance that is larger than three times the standard deviation from the centroids. So in this case, you see that we have almost 14 million of cells. You see here, we have more or less 14 million of data out of 16 million that have not been classified. And so we let's be used to the facts that, for example, you see here in the water, we don't have anything that is all not classified. That, for example, here you see the deforested area. We have in yellow are very underrepresented, while these blue things are forest. There's no water at all. Let's check if we have the clouds here. You see, we have the contour of the clouds, but you see that the major part of the cells have not been classified because they are too far in this algorithm from the centroids. You see that this is not a very good result in this sense, but it's just to be prepared for the next labs, because when we are using supervised algorithm, we need to get used to the fact that there can be cells that have not been classified by the algorithm, because we were not able to extract the ROI of all the different surfaces that are in the image. So in this case, we are finishing. So thank you for your attention, and we will see next time for the lab number 9. So we'll talk about supervised classification. Goodbye and take care.